Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Welcome to Creator Lutheran Church. We give thanks to God that we have been gathered by the Holy Spirit. We had a service at Driftwood Point and the mountain even was out, even though there was hail yesterday and frigid temperatures, but God shows up and gives us new life on this wonderful day. After service today, you're welcome to stay and participate in a brunch that we have as well. And next week, we will be having Bishop Jake with us to present a new book that we will be doing called The World is About to Turn. So he'll be participating in worship while I'll be preaching, but he'll be presenting in between services if you're able to come back next week for that opportunity. Let us rise as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. We worship in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us come into the light, the revealing and healing light of God. God of grace and glory, you have brought us through the night of sin into the light of Jesus' resurrection. Yet our lives are still shadowed by sin. Make us alive in Christ, O God. Make us new as you may make all things new. Rescue us from evil and the gloom of sin. Renew us in grace and restore us to living in your holiness. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Rejoice with all creation around God's throne. The light of the risen Christ has put to flight all evil deeds, washes away sin, restores innocence to the fallen, casts out hate, brings peace, and humbles earthly pride. Jesus Christ has freed you from your sins by his death and resurrection. By the authority of Christ, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
O God, you gave our only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from Isaiah, the 65th chapter. I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 years will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. When they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. But the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Word of God, word of life. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ, but each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. Word of God, word of life.
I'd like to invite the children who are with us to please come forward for a children's sermon. You can come and sit down right in front of me here. Good morning. Come on up. Well, hello. My name is Pastor Amanda. It's good to see all of you. If you ever have any questions about what's happening in church, don't hesitate to ask, because sometimes there's a lot to learn about what we do here, isn't there? Well, I have some things here I want to show you. They're kind of starting to get a little wilty, but last week was a special day called Palm Sunday. And we had, these were all green back then. They're already kind of turned colors, haven't they? They were green, and we all put them up and shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." And the word Hosanna means save us. And the what they we thought is, and they thought when they said that back in Jesus' time, was that God, Jesus was coming to save them just like any other king. He was going to put a crown, a gold crown on his head and sit in a big throne and be a powerful leader, a powerful king. Do you have a question? When they pick them when they're green, because that way that we can wave them, because right now they're kind of crinkly, aren't they? That's what they actually did when Jesus went through Jerusalem. They took the palm branches off the trees, and they laid it down on the road so that he would pass over on those green branches and not get all dirty. That's why we do the same thing now. We don't put them on the ground, though. We wave them in the air to remember that. That's a good question. Yeah. I dropped one of my crosses. Thank you. So what I did is I took these branches because Jesus doesn't save us like a normal person, a normal king. He doesn't save us by ruling in a throne room and putting a big fancy crown on his head. Jesus saves us on the cross. And so what I did is I took all of those extra branches and I made a cross for every one of you. Because how Jesus actually saves us is through the cross. You three want to come up a little closer? I can't quite reach you. Come on and get a cross, everybody. There you go. There you go. There you go. And one more. Here you go. So Jesus saves us, but not how we expected. Jesus saves us by dying on the cross. But guess what we celebrate today? That Jesus, by dying on the cross, he actually was resurrected. So he is not dead anymore. He is alive. And so we say once again, Alleluia. Can you say that with me? Alleluia. Let's stand up. Oh, you need to say this a little bit more energy. So Alleluia is something you feel in yourself, okay? I'm going to drop a bunch of them. So, Alleluia, can we go, kind of, let's crunch on down, and then I want you to jump up and shout Alleluia, okay? One, two, three. Alleluia! Should we try it one more time? Okay. Got to feel it inside of you. It's the best news of the day. One, two, three. Alleluia! Okay. So, I want you to share that good news, that Jesus saves us on the cross. And we can say, Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And you all get one of these when you leave church today as well. So they're in the back for you because we're all children of God. You may go back to your seats. Please rise as you are able for a gospel acclamation. The Gospel according to Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the first day of the week at early dawn, the women came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all of this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen clothes by themselves. Then he went home amazed at what had happened. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, since I moved here 2 years ago, we've gone through a lot of transitions. And I've taken a lot of time in my personal house to do some renovations. And those have involved a few thresholds, even ones that didn't end up fitting after we cut them apart. But we've also been talking through the time of Lent here at Creator about threshold moments of our life. We've called it liminal Lent because a limen is actually the Latin word for threshold. So as we go through those thresholds of life, the liminal seasons of our life are those times when we're crossing into something new and the familiar has ended. But now something completely unknown is our current reality. What had worked for us before isn't working for us anymore. Liminal times are times when there's an ending, when things have stopped, and the new beginning has not yet come. This time is known for its disorientation. It's a season of transition. We've been in this season for a long time. I know I've been doing daily videos throughout Lent, and I think I'm as sick of liminal time as anybody. We're ready to move on, but that timing isn't always in our hands, is it? Sometimes the threshold is not ready. Sometimes it's not the right one. And yet, God comes to us and works in these threshold moments of our life, reorienting us to something new. Because after all, He is the God of ending and new beginnings, of death and resurrection. So what are those threshold moments that you've been going through in your life this last year, this last month, maybe even the last few moments? God works in these times. In our reading from Isaiah, we hear these gorgeous words from this prophetic prophet. And we wonder, are they prediction or are they promise of creating new heavens and new earth, of a time of rejoicing and gladness and delight, where there'll be no more sounds of weeping and no more cries of distress, where infants and elders will be living full long lives, and they won't be snatched away by death. Because the reality for us in our world, in our life, is the one thing that we're taught that is certain is death, that it will find all of us. It's certain, and yet it's the one thing we try to hide all the time, to hide from. We mask it. The women were bringing spices to mask the scent of death that day where Christ was entombed. And so we hear this promise from Isaiah, this prediction from Isaiah, and it seems too good to be true. But then this promise continues. Isaiah says there'll be no labor in vain. Or we won't bear our children in calamity. What a message for our world today. The fear of those existential threats, a purpose of life, with all the pain and suffering and death around us. I don't know about you, and I've mentioned this a few times, but I've been reading way too many dystopian novels because they feel hopeful these days. And I wonder how easily things change in our lives and how fragile life is. And yet we have this promise of peace, that God will protect us from the danger and create us anew. And the promise is that before we even call, God will answer. While that we are still speaking, God will hear. And yet Christ had spoke these promises, And the disciples didn't understand. And yet when Christ was raised from the dead, it was called an idle tale. So today, once again, we hear this story that's at the heart of our Christian faith, and we remember. We remember the threshold that Christ crossed over when he died. That sadness and that guilt because of the betrayal that he suffered that were felt in the disciples and in the women and all those who loved Jesus. They were disoriented in this liminal time that they were in. And they were clinging to the customs that they knew, to go through with emotions, to honor their loved one. And then their expectations turn into something completely different, and they are perplexed because the stone is rolled away and there's no body. There's two men with dazzling clothes standing there. They had come to see the dead, and dead people are supposed to stay dead. That's a certainty of life, right? And yet Jesus was not there. What the women had been holding on to was no longer going to help them. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? Well, because he died, and we saw him die, and death is death, and it's the end, and death has this firm grip on us, and we see it as the end. He's not here, but has arisen. Something new has happened. So what do we do now? What do we think? What do we feel? What? Remember how he told you that the Son of Man must suffer, must be handed over, betrayed, die, and will rise again. The thing is, how we hear something when it's said and how we come to understand it later, how it becomes clear, at times it feels like two different messages are given. Somebody told you the thing, and you thought you understood it, but it turns out you didn't understand it at all. Happens all the time with my husband and I. Jesus had told them about his upcoming passion, and they had heard it as a prediction, not a promise. It might come true or it might not. Perhaps it could be avoided if they worked hard or if they had a different plan. Each time the disciples reacted against this prediction of death because it sounded like judgment. God's own Son came down from heaven and lived among us, and we handed him over. We betrayed him. What's wrong with us? At the time, they did not want to imagine, did not want to entertain the thought of opening that door, of crossing that threshold, that Jesus, their beloved, would actually die. Can you imagine if they had to fill out a health care directive for Jesus back in the day? What would you say? Jesus, what are your decisions upon end of life? Do you want to have extraordinary means taken on that cross so that you can survive? What songs would you like at your funeral, Jesus? What are your wishes, Jesus? You know, I have at home a fun little game. I don't know if fun is the word, but it's called the Death Deck. So if you ever want to come over, invite me over to your house, we can answer questions like, after I kick the bucket, announce my death on social media, A, pretty quickly, I'd like everyone to know ASAP, never, please don't tweet my demise, whenever, I really don't care, I'm dead. And there's about maybe 100 more of these. Maybe none of you will ever invite me to your houses now. But if you want. But now, two men in dazzling light white are at an empty tomb, and there's no body. And the women are rehearing those words. He's not here, but has risen. It's no longer a prediction. It's no longer something to work around. It's now here. Jesus has fulfilled his promise. He is risen. For the women, it's a promise now, a promise to hold on to and be held by. For Jesus had known that his purpose was resurrection. He had brought to the world the certainty, not of death, but of life, of new creation, of resurrection from the dead. Dead people don't stay dead. Now, because those who believe in Christ Jesus are new creations, We are new creations. We have this promise to hold on to. Even when we fill out healthcare directives, even when we plan funerals, even when we lower caskets, even when we sprinkle ashes, even when we are predictors of resurrection, we are actually holders of the promise of resurrection. The women remembered and returned to tell the others, the 11 and all the rest, and the disciples did not immediately receive this as good news. They didn't know if it was good or not for them. In death's firm grip, their idle tales of empty tombs seemed like utter nonsense. It sounded more likely like grave robbery or some other trick because the dead stay dead. Our world will continue to tell you that this is utter nonsense. Maybe death is too real for you today. Maybe the existential threats are muting your joy and squashing your hope. Perhaps you are at a threshold moment of your own in this liminal season that we've been living in way too long. What used to work maybe is not working anymore. Maybe something or some relation or someone's life has ended, and you are left staring at an ending and wondering what will come now that familiar is no longer an option, even though you wish it was, even though you realize how much you took for granted, even though the known stress is sometimes easier than the unknown stress, or so we tell ourselves. You see, Peter and the disciples are where we are often today on this Easter morning, with doubt, with incredulity that they go to the tomb. And what they find at the tomb is all the trappings of death that remained. The linen clothes, the tomb itself where the body had laid, the stone that had been protecting the body, the spices that would have masked the stench of death are all still there. We are still often looking for the living among the dead. But he's not here. He has risen. The empty tomb is not the gospel. The trappings of death are left behind, and Jesus is the gospel. He has crossed the threshold from death to life, and now what will Jesus do out of the tomb and beyond death? Well, on that first Easter, he went to find his disciples who were cowering in fear and guilt. They were perplexed. They were, and released them from their liminal seasons and from their tombs of betrayal and guilt, and gave them new life. Jesus continues to do this most important work, giving you the certainty of resurrection, of new life, new creation. Out of the moments when all has changed and all seems lost, he carries you over the threshold into new life. That, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, is why the Holy Spirit gathered you today. Because we need to hear this new word of resurrection today. You have been carried across this threshold. Today you are reminded that Christ died. Most importantly, however, today you are given the promise, the gift of resurrection, because this is what Christ does. Christ has carried you across the threshold from death to life and given you that life, taken you out of your tombs, and freed you. You all have your own tombs that you have been in, each and every one of us. And while you were yet speaking, he heard. And before you even called, he answered. So let us rejoice and be glad, for Christ did all of this for you and for me and for the world. Alleluia. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
On this day of resurrection joy, let us offer our prayers for ourselves, our neighbors, and our world. Renewing God, the good news of your resurrection changed the world. Give church leaders and all the baptized the same excitement as the women at the tomb, and inspire us to share your abundant life. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Sustaining God, your creation abounds with signs of new life in budding trees and newborn creatures. Provide fertile soil, ample sunlight, and nourishing rain for the growth of plants, and provide farmers with a plentiful harvest. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Sheltering God, strengthen and sustain all who support vulnerable people across the world, those who are refugees, experiencing war, or suffering under the continued effects of the global pandemic. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Encouraging God, you do a new thing among us. We pray for those gripped by the fear and anxiety, or who suffer in any way. Send us your healing presence to places of hunger, pain, illness, or overwhelming sorrow. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Surprising God, you offer endless ways for us to delight in your grace. Give the community of faith a sense of joy and wonder in exploring new avenues of faith formation, worship, and discipleship. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Resurrecting God, you make us alive in Christ. Thank you for blessing us with faithful witnesses who now rest in you. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We offer to you those petitions we carry in our hearts, trusting in your abundant and ever-present mercy. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share that peace with one another.
As we receive our morning offering. Thank you. Please rise as you are able. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you raised us to new life, Christ, give us glad and generous hearts. Praise you to those in need. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is our duty and delight that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and ever-living God. But chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord. For he is the true Passover Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his raising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to invite the communion assistants to please come forward. We'll be communing at two stations in front. You'll be invited forward by the ushers and we'll be given bread. And then you may take either wine or grape juice and then place your empty glasses on the side baskets. If you need gluten-free communion, please let us know. Also, if you're unable to come forward, please let the ushers know and we will bring communion to you. Those of you who are worshiping from home, and if you are participating in communion, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given and shed for you. The table has been prepared by our Lord. Come. Rise as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, generous God, for this bread and cup. We have tasted the new heaven and earth, where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives all may live. In Jesus' name. Amen. Receive the blessing of our Lord. The blessing of our Lord God, the blessing of Christ, the Lamb who was slain, and the blessing of the Holy Spirit of truth be among and remain with you always. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Comes right out of there. Amen.